take some more implementation scenarios using OpenCV and in previous session we were discussing about different algorithms for edge detection like Kenny edge detection or Harris Corner. So I will show you quickly the implementation of Kenny on real-time webcam streaming, and after that we will discuss about other algorithms for feature points detection like shift, surf, plan feature detection, and the way we can work with image forgery detection. So as you can see, that same code I am using for Kenny edge detection, but with CV2.video capture. As you can see that, so whosoever is in front of the camera, you can see real time images, real time video from that algorithm. So we can also modify these algorithms, and on actual images, on actual webcam integrations, we can perform these things. So we have modified the threshold value. So there are three parameters except image. One is the matrix, and next to with the threshold value. Threshold means the nearby pixels, which particular matrix we have to take. So it depends on the implementation part, on a particular research problem on which you want to implement it. Okay. Now if we discuss about, are you getting the audio? Dear participants, please confirm, are you getting the audio? Because one participant is saying that no audio.
Yes sir, the audio is fine. I'll just write it in the chat box, Sir Avanti P. So you can continue.
Okay. Now we will see other implementations, other approaches for feature point extraction. As you can see, I'm opening this shift algorithm. Okay, this algorithm is also available in MATLAB, but definitely, as we have discussed earlier, that MATLAB is a proprietary software and we have to pay for it. In case of OpenCV, this algorithm for feature points extraction is available with this function. You can see that cv2.xfeatures2d and shift underscore create. You can see that, and on upper layer of shift, if we want to improve the performance of shift, or if we want to use shift for image forgery detection, then we can take another algorithm, that is your plan feature detection. There are so many algorithms available. So shift is one of the very basic algorithm, one of the very prominent algorithm for feature points extraction. Now if I take a particular image, suppose any particular image we can take. And this image is flower.jpg or flower.jpg. Suppose suppose with this image, just for testing. Okay, I want to implement split algorithm, and we want to fetch out the feature points using shift algorithm, that is scale invariant algorithm. For that, first of all, we have to import U2 and we convert that image to RGB from PGR to grayscale, and then cv2.xfeatures2d.shift_create. So there is no need to floor entire matrix. As far as I'm aware, that from where we can get database for practice, I will share you the URLs. Okay, from UCI also you can take data sets. From Kaggle also you can take the data sets. There are multiple data sets available. You can take all these. After this session, I will with the study material, I will share all the URLs from where you can get these data sets. Okay. And you can see that key descriptors and key points. And finally, we see draw key points. So whatever key points we have obtained using shift, that we can draw. So this is your Google, and if I take flower.jpg, now you can see that this flower.jpg is tortured with some key feature points. So now using shift algorithm, it is not taking only the edges, it is taking the interior details also. Interior details means which other parts of this particular image are unique to this specific snap, this specific photograph. Okay. So rather than taking only the edges or only corners, we can go to interior details. So if you take any other image from this, suppose index.png, I can see that from this image you can find out different key descriptors. And as far as the image data sets are concerned, one of the best sources your UCI, Kaggle, or you can take complete data set from ImageNet data set. How many of you are aware with ImageNet? Yes or no in chat box. What is ImageNet data set? ImageNet data set. Have you heard about ImageNet data set? ImageNet is that data set which is having all the images, which is having the images of all objects in this world, from a needle to aircraft. Each and everything is there. Millions of images are available on ImageNet. So whenever you will study about deep learning, when we discuss about deep learning models or pre-trained models, actually ImageNet we use for pre-trained models of deep learning and its fine tuning. One is ImageNet model, and so many other models are available. ImageNet is the data set, and we can use VGG16, VGG8, VGG32, ImageNet also, ResNet also, MobileNet also. There are so many convolutional networks in deep learning networks. We use so many pre-trained models. And suppose you are working on any X-ray image or any ultrasound image, then what we do, we fine-tune these models. The process of fine-tuning is done. So whenever you will study about deep learning in tomorrow's session, then you will you may be covering this point, that what is meaning of fine-tuning of deep learning models. So using shift, we can extract the feature points. Even you can take any other image also, or real-time image you can also take from internet. Okay, it doesn't matter that you will have to work only on a specific image. You can take any particular image. Suppose I'm taking this image, so screenshot of this and our key.jpg, and this image I'm placing in same folder, and now flower.jpg. Now you can see that image which we have just downloaded, its key feature points are extracted. Key feature points means edges as well as interior details. So if you are working on X-ray data, if you are working on MRI data, if you are working on satellite data, roads data, traffic lights data, or some river network data, in that case we use these algorithms, SIFT algorithm. Okay, so at the bottom line, at the base level, we make use of these algorithms, and this is available by default. And as one query is there, that can we use ImageNet without downloading it? Actually, what we have to do, whenever we use ImageNet model, we download the complete network. We download the complete model. Its model is available. Okay, ImageNet model. I will share its code also. Okay, however, it is not concerned to this session. Still. You can mail me, I will mail you separately how to work with ImageNet or VGC16 or ResNet or MobileNet. All these things we can work, and inside these networks we can put our own images, we can put our own data set for fine tuning. Okay, and as far as the improvements in this particular algorithm is concerned, as far as another variant of SIFT algorithm is concerned, there is another algorithm that is known as SURF algorithm. SURF algorithm is the enhanced version of SIFT, or you can say that it is the improved version in terms of speed. Okay, in terms of speed. So you can also see this SIFT SURF. If you want to see the complete documentation, you can see that. Within OpenCV documentation, this is available, and I will show its execution also in OpenCV. So why I am showing you each and all these things in OpenCV site, so that you can come to know that each and everything is available on official portal. Each and everything is available on OpenCV official website. So you can see that speeded up robust features. Sorry, and its source code. This is the source code. Okay, so if you want to see the source code, this. So from any image, if you want to find out the source code, you want to find out the feature points. As you can see, this is the image of a butterfly. So its key feature points are identified using SURF. So this. If I take that thing in here, so one is this, and second is flower tree. .jpg. Now you will see the difference. So this is your SURF and this is your SIFT. Okay. Whenever researchers or research scholars start working on image processing, if they take this particular research area, whether it is image quality detection or segmentation or whatever it is, so this is the very first step that we have to follow. So these are the very basic algorithms. These are very preliminary algorithms that every researcher explores before actual implementation. Whether you are working on videos or you are working on some particular images, suppose I want how many feature points I want to create. So you can see 100, only 100. If I want to take only pretty best features, so you can see that this is also not required. I'm cutting down the code. Now you can see this is the code. CV2.x features 20.sub_create. How many features? 20 best features. So 20 best features, which are these and in this then in this particular image, which are the key points, which are the feature points using which we can identify this particular image. Okay, and if we discuss about a particular domain that is concerned with image forgery detection, using interior detection, interior features. I am covering that thing for signature forgery. I am covering that point. Okay, how to work on signature forgery. Okay, image forgery detection, or you can see that whether it is signature based forgery detection or it is concerned with some image morphing. Many times it happens that some particular photo is morphed, a particular image is modified with head of somebody else, okay, or body of somebody else. Then by which way we can identify? So for that, what we do, there is a specific algorithm, slant features matcher, and this algorithm makes use of shift by default. Okay, at the base level we can use shift, or surf also we can use. Okay, so what you can do, so at the bottom level we can find out the feature points using shift, and then using slant features matcher we can extract the key points, whether it is a signature or it is something else. Now if I show you the documentation of slant features in OpenCV official website, then I will show you the demonstration. As you can see, you can see that all source codes are available. I am showing you on the WordPress page just to confirm to all of you that each and everything is available. All codes are available. See that if this particular book is taken from some other particular source, some particular image set, then these feature points can be directly matched like this. Okay, and you can see that this is slant feature matcher, fast library for approximate nearest neighbors. So what we do in slant feature matcher, at the back end we can implement, so first of all what we do, extract read both images, then extract features using shift or surf or your algorithm or whatever algorithm you are using for feature points, and then apply slant library for features matching. And features matching for, it can be implemented for signatures, it can be used for photographs, or it can be used for document forgery. Suppose some particular roll number is cut out and a new roll number is placed by copy and paste from some other source, then we can easily match it. So if I implement same thing, now you can see, I'll show you that code, this plan features matcher. Okay, now you can see, and now I'm opening two things. Check one, check two. Is it visible to all of you? Now I will apply signature forgery or signature matching on two documents. Suppose one signature I copy from here and I put some other check. Then using plan feature matcher and at the back end with shift, whether we are able to identify that there is forgery or not. So plan features, its code is available, so we take it and we can perform the implementation on our images. This is another image. I'm modifying the image URL. This is check one, check two. This is check one dot jpg and this check. Now you can see that at backend, first of all, this is same process that we have written in Notepad file. In Notepad file, what we have written, same, this is same thing. First of all, read both images. And after reading the images, implement surf or shift, whatever you want to implement, using which technique you want to find out the feature points. Once feature points are obtained, then simply plan tree matcher. Now is it visible to all of you? Are you able to do this? This particular signature is directly nothing here. So both of the documents are available. So if I keep it as it is, check one, check two. So this is check one, this is check two. Suppose this is one document, this is tax and this is income tax return. Now if I want to check, if I want to analyze whether these signatures are forged or not, whether actual signature is done or some particular photoshopping or using some particular tool it is done. So I have to change the file names. And you can see that signatures are directly matched, that this signature is matching with this particular signature directly. Okay, and most of the features, maximum features, are matching from these two documents. Is it visible to all the participants? Are you able to view this? So you can implement it on your own data set, on your own images. If you take a particular image and you copy paste directly to another thing, suppose I am taking any other document, for example flower. Okay, this is flower.png, this is flower.png, and now I am creating a copy of this. This is flower3.png. now in flower3.png, if I open it in Photoshop, and I will try to modify this thing, I will add something. Now you can see I am taking only this part. Only this part I have taken, and on a new image, I want to put it. Suppose it is g.png file. Like this. Okay. Same. This is g.png and second is not flower.png. So It is fast library. FLAN stands for fast library. FLAN is for fast library. I can see that. Is it visible for you? Are you able to see this? That this flower is matching from this particular image. So, if I have pasted the image to any other photograph, to any other thing, then only this particular image is matching with this particular image. Other particular feature points are not matched. So, by this way, we can work with image forgery, we can work with document forgery, or we can go for some other manipulation identifications or for image forensics. This type of implementations can be done. And as far as Jeep tire, few of the pixels might be matching with that, but most of the matching is done. Most of the matching is done with this. Okay, as far as this is concerned, few of pixels may be matching. It's no issue. But if we check its overall performance, then we can check that more than 80% or more than 90% matching is on this particular area. Okay. In similar way, if you will see C1, C2. This is C1. This is C2. This is C1. This is check. So if I modify this in C1 and C2, this Photoshop and this also. These two signatures are matching. If others are matching, in that case, to 1%, to 2%, but maximum these two are matching. So by this way, you can see, and I have written in code also what is full form of FLAN. This is fast library for approximate nearest neighbors. There is another library also with name brute force. You will see here. Okay, now suppose if you are doing research, so for doing research, actually what happens whenever we work for any research paper or any presentation, we try to directly jump to major implementation part. Okay, suppose we are working on a new algorithm, we try to get the code of that algorithm directly. Okay, rather than that, first of all, see which different or existing algorithms are there for that thing. If you are working on image forgery or signature forgery or something else, then you can see which techniques are available for forgery detection or key feature points matching. So one technique is FLAN and second is brute force. Let's see that this is FLAN and this is brute force or ORB descriptors. Okay, ORB descriptors. So what we can do, one manuscript or one implementation we can do for a comparative evaluation between brute force matching and the FLAN features detection. By this way, you will get some results, and obviously those results will be empirical results. And simple handwritten signatures can also be used. Any type of things, any type of data sample you can take, and you can see that each and everything is available. So these type of functions are not available in MATLAB or other packages. So that's why it's advisable to explore this package, to explore this library for image analytics, as there will be no issue of source code. You will get all the source code. You can see that this source code, if you will directly copy and you will run it in Spider or Jupyter, it will execute. So what you have to do, simply change this name, change this data. You will have to modify this data only. Okay, Instead of MATLAB, what we do, we go to mathworks.com or mathworks.in or whatever it is, and then we try to get some codes. Okay, and even if we are having source code, even if we are having some particular code of MATLAB, that is not customizable. That is the major issue because of which many times we struck, and we have to go for some open source library. So by this way you can work with this. So what you can do, you can work with this thing. Imperative evaluation. Planned and brute force method. Okay, and it will be your empirical work because data set is yours. You are using your own images, you are using your own system, so you can note down the system. So suppose you are having two laptops or multiple systems, same algorithm with same data set, you can implement on multiple systems, then you can note down. Okay, on 32-bit system, this is the output. And this much time it took. Okay, for on 64-bit system, in this much time it, these algorithms are implemented. And by this way, you will be having your own results, and all these are will be publishable results. Okay. It doesn't matter. So directly, rather than moving to research-based implementations, first of all, try to implement your existing approaches with data sets on multiple architectures. So if you are not having multiple systems, what you can do, same implementation you can do on your laptop, same implementation you can perform on Google Cloud. Then compare the results. It will be your empirical output. It will be your empirical result. And you can perform a particular pragmatic analysis of this type of implementation. Now, before this, I want to cover one more topic that is known as your working with R Castlet. Yes, definitely we can plot using matplotlib. Plotting can be done. What you can do, you can take the results of execution time and all these things, and those results can be put in a text file, or those results can be put in some array, and then you can plot using matplotlib. So all these things can be done. Now we'll see how to work with R cascades for images. Even if we are working on videos, then we can take, you can extract the images from that video. So what is R cascade? R cascade, it is basically, in very simple language, not in very much technical things, in very simple language, what is R cascade? It is a trained XML document or trained XML file with features of specific objects. Okay, trained XML file using machine learning with specific features of specific objects. Where we use R cascades to broadly identify the objects. To broadly identify the objects or to detect the objects. Okay, we use R cascades to broadly identify the objects. So what is meaning of this, whether it is a human or not, whether human face or not, whether it is a vehicle or not, whether it is a car or not, okay, whether a particular thing is smiling or not, smiling face or not. Now if I am having R-casted file, R-casted model of human face with lips, it will not cover smiling face with lips. Okay, if I want to work with smiling face or smile detection, you might have seen that there is a specific domain of research in image processing that is known as smile detection. Okay, many researchers work on this particular field, that smile detection. I want to, suppose I am having a data set of 100 images, I want to analyze out of these 100 images which persons were smiling, which persons are having smiling face, okay, which persons are having depressing face. So however, it might be looking some something comedy for you, but this is the fact, and there are so many people working on this. So I can show you Google Scholar also. So many people are, many researchers are working on this particular domain, smiling face detection, smiling detection algorithm. You can see that I have not written, still it is showing that smile detection algorithm. You can see smile detection using Bezier curve, smile detection. Okay, if I want to say that depression face detection, so many algorithms. Video based detection of clinical depressions in adolescents. Okay, you can see that, yes, definitely some how many persons might be drunk. Okay, suppose a particular face is there, suppose I am having this particular face, human face. So I want to identify from eyes, I want to identify from face that whether this particular person is drunk or not. If drunk, then how much possibility is there that only 30 ml is taken or 60 ml is taken or half bottle is consumed. Okay, so from lips, from eyes, from forehead, from cheeks, we can evaluate. So for that thing we have to work with R cascades. Okay, if you are taking a new data set, if you are working on a new research domain, if you are working on a new algorithm for smoke detection or any other thing, in that case, suppose this is a place. Okay, this is another case also. So this place, now you can see that this place is simple, and this, now you can see that this is smiling face, but it is not. Okay, if I will apply face detection, a hard cascade of face detection on this place, on this particular data set, on this particular image, smile will not be captured because it is not a full smile. Okay, but we can modify that particular trained model also, but it will be covered. Okay, I will show you that thing also, how to work. So is it clear to all of you what is meaning of hard cascade? So if I am working, if I want to extract only eyes to identify the eyes, so there must be the hard cascade of XML file of IR cascade. Okay, if I want to work on face, then it must be there, face. If I want to work on car, vehicles, then XML file of vehicles, it will be required. So XML, what is XML file? It is having weights, it is having pre-trained model of that particular object. If I want to identify whether it is a cat or not, in that case I will have to create R cascade file, or I will have to download or Cascade file of cat. Okay, if it is not available on GitHub, then we have to create it. Okay, so if I show you frontalface.xml file, these two files I have already downloaded. You can download it from internet. These are available. Now you can see that. Yes. Okay. Now you can see. If the time will permit, I will show that demo also the trained model. Okay. So first of all, I will cover all these things, and if time will allow, then I will show that theme also, how to work with pre-trained model. Okay, now you can see this thing. So this is the R-casted file of human face, and this I have already downloaded, and this is R-casted file of eye. So this is the structure. This is having, you can see all these points are given, all these values are given. These are feature points, features, weights, you can associate it. Now if I implement, face, and so if I do not include this R-casted file, in that case my code will not run. This code will not execute if I will not add this particular classifier. So this is the classifier. It is known as casted classifier, and this is the code only. You can see that in 15 to 20 lines of code, not 20 after removing the comments and blank line, it will be only 15 lines of code. And the main thing is done using this thing. Using this XML file, okay. R-casted frontal, and which file I want to take, face.jpg. So I'm showing you that file, face.jpg. Yes, this is face.jpg file. Now, if I want to analyze this particular whether it is a human face or not, then this. Now you can see this face is identified along with eye. Why it is evaluating the eyes? Because R cascade of eye is also added. The R cascade of eye is also added here. This. If I do not include this R cascade eye file, in that case eyes will not be identified. In that case, eyes will be skipped. If we take any other file, suppose faces. Now this is faces.jpg. Suppose I use this thing, this particular image, or this image faces 2. This is faces 2. Now you see. Faces 2, and in faces 2 you can see in both of the images whether it is smiling or not, face as well as eyes are extracted. Okay, and from which technique it is implementing? Using these two XML files. If you do not use this pre-trained R model, pre-trained R cascade models, in that case it will not be done. In deep learning also we use this type of pre-trained models. Actually it is a very small file, XML file, but when we use deep learning, in that case the pre-trained models are in GBs. In gigabytes. Now if I take this pieces, now you can see this is also extracted. So any image from internet you can take, and that you can pass. Eye cascade for detection of eyes and this human face. So it is a very lightweight code, very simple code that you can directly integrate in any Raspberry Pi board or in any Arduino board. And as and now I'll show you a one demo of pre-trained model. How to work with pre-trained models? What is actually pre-trained model in case of deep learning? However, I'm not doing that part, but because it will be covered tomorrow. But I'll show you how to work quickly in pre-trained models and by which way we can predict the images, by which way we can classify the images using some pre-trained models. I'm having that slide also. I'll show you. I'll open that directly. Okay. ImageNet. Okay. This is it visible to all of you? Are you able to view this slide? ImageNet. You can see that millions of images are available in ImageNet model, in ImageNet dataset. Basically, ImageNet is a dataset that we can use for our research and development. And so many pre-trained models are developed so far, which uses ImageNet at the back end. And as you can see that ResNet is available, PGG16 is available. So I'll show you that slide directly. I'm not covering deep learning part because I'm a resource person. So you can see that these are different pre-trained models. AlexNet, VGG16, VGSampling, any of these you can take. MobileNet, DenseNet, InceptionV, GoogleNet. So all these pre-trained models can be taken for fine-tuning, and those fine-tuned models can be used for other predictions. Now I'm showing you directly that implementation part. And inside code, I'll tell you. And in that, I will use a VGG model in my Google Collab. Is it visible to all the participants? Are you getting the audio and screen, both of these clearly? Are you getting the audio and screen clearly? Now you can see that. Whenever we work with pre-trained models for deep learning, we have to take care, we have to import the libraries of TensorFlow. So no need to get panic of this, I'll tell you everything. So this is enlarged. So you can see that I'm using Google Colab and I'm checking whether GPU is working or not. Okay, GPU save and connect. Okay, so what we do? From Kerasto applications, go to VGG16. What is VGG16? VGG16 is the pre-trained model that is already available in Google Colab. Okay, VGG16 is a pre-trained model. what is VGG16? If I show you that, what is difference between VGG16 and VGG19? You can see that in VGG16 deep neural network there are 16 layers. In VGG19 there are 19 layers. Size of data set is this. Okay, how many parameters are there? 138 million parameters. So obviously VGG19 model is complex. Is complex as compared to VGG16. Okay, VGG19 is having more layers. Image size is 224 by 224, 224 by 224 image size, height, width. And if we see that DenseNet 201, DenseNet 201 is having 201 layers. So it is very simple to remember. If I am using ResNet 50, 50 means 50 layers I am using. If I am using ResNet 101, it means I am using 101 layers. Okay. If I am using this, okay, in other numbering is not given, but if numbering is given, it is very easy to remember that VGG16 is having 16 layers of deep network. Okay. Now that we have imported and this model is created, model is equal to VGG16. Okay. And you can see that, and from that you can see that we have imported the model. This object is created, which is 16. It's up to you. You can take 19 also. You can take ResNet also. And now to upload the image from my system, what I will do, I want to, so obviously now I will show you how to predict a particular image. Now from Google I am taking a particular image. Suppose I am taking an image of a squirrel. Okay. Now randomly I am taking a particular image from internet. This is a squirrel and I am copying it. I am downloading it sq.jpg. On desktop it is my image sq.jpg. Now I want to identify, suppose I don't know what is this particular object. Now I want to predict using VGG16 model with ImageNet at the back end. What is this? What is this sq.jpg? Okay, or not sq.jpg, suppose g9.jpg. This is file g9.jpg. Suppose I don't know what is this object. Using VGG16 model at the back end of ImageNet, I have told you earlier that ImageNet is a database, ImageNet is a data set that is having each and everything from needle to aircraft. Each and everything is available, all types of lions, all types of squirrels, all types of ceiling fan, all type of ACs, all type of washing machines, each and everything is there. So now I will match this object with that pre-trained model. So for that obviously I have to upload this file. For that I will use this code from google.colab import files and uploaded is equal to files.upload. I will upload my image using this function. I think you might have covered this thing. How many of you are aware with this thing, how to upload a file, how to upload a data set on Google Collaboratory? Yes or no? If I want to upload a file, if I want to upload a file using browse button, then this is used. Okay. Now, which image? My image is g9.jpg. Okay. Target size is 224 by 224. What is target size? Whatever image size is this, automatically it will be in height width 224 by 224. Why? Because I have shown you that slide. In case of VGG16, it takes image size of 224 by 224, height and width. So size means height and width. Okay. So if I take a particular image of, suppose if I want to check this image size, it is, its size is, what is this particular size? This, okay. 128 by 148. Okay. Automatically it will become 224 by 224 because VGG16 or VGG19 will take image size of 224 by 224. Okay, we will check whether it will take or not. And g9.jpg, I will upload it, and now I am executing this code, and it will ask me to upload the file, and now I am uploading that squirrel image, and okay. Now it will check whether it is able to classify, whether it is able to classify or not. If it is able to classify, then what it is classifying, whether it is a squirrel or any other animal. Now you can see that it is downloading the data and performing the matching. And as you can see that using TensorFlow at backend, Keras is the upper layer of TensorFlow. So whenever we work with Keras, automatically TensorFlow works at the backend. Now you can see it is written that fox squirrel 99.1%. It means the image I have uploaded, that is a squirrel and fox squirrel, and its probability is 99.1% probability of being fox squirrel. Is it visible to all of you? Are you able to view this? 99.1% accuracy is there that it is fox squirrel. Okay. Now I want to see what is actually fox squirrel. Now I am opening Google Images. On Google, I want to see what is actually fox squirrel, and on images. Now you can see this is the same squirrel or same type of squirrel that I have uploaded. Okay, so all these images of squirrel are already trained. Now I will, if I take any other image, suppose I am taking a lion, and then I want to predict it using that model, using that VG model. So I am taking this image randomly and L8, any name L8. Okay, and in code also I will have to put this code, this file L8.jpg, and run. Then I will see whether it is able to classify as lion or something else. Now I will upload L8 image, and in this case there is a XML file. Now you can see, is it visible to all of you? It is lion, and 99.95% accuracy that it is a lion that we have uploaded. Is it visible to all of you that the image is identified as lion? Okay, are you able to view this prediction using pre-trained model? Okay, if I take any other thing, suppose other than animal, if I want to check like guitar, anything, suppose this guitar I want to take. I want to see what is this G7, anything. Okay. Now I will upload this image G7, and now I will use VGG16 model with ImageNet. As far as own data, own research is concerned, you can consider it is acoustic guitar. Is it visible to all of you? It is acoustic guitar, and it's like 65.1%. So definitely an acoustic guitar. Is it visible to all of you? Okay. Now, if I want to see what is this acoustic guitar, on Google Images, I can check the images of acoustic guitar. So you can see this is the same image, same type of image that we have uploaded and predicted using VGG16 model. Now, as far as research is concerned, how to now the very basic question arises that how do we use this for our own research? Suppose you are doing research on X-ray data, MRI data, or some ultrasound data. or any other face recognition. In that case, what we do, there is a specific process of fine tuning, that is known as fine tuning of models. Okay, this model that we have used with GPT-16, it is a pre-trained model of generic images, of general millions of images. So what we do at the time of fine tuning the model, we modify the weights. We have to modify the weights of this particular model, and we have to add some layers. So what you can do, you can explore the fine tuning of models in deep learning, and in other sessions of deep learning also you might be covering this thing, that what is fine tuning. Fine tuning means if a particular model is given to you, then how to fine tune that model with your own data set, how to integrate your own data, how to add some more layers. As in VGG16, there are 16 layers. What we can do, we can add two more layers in this. Okay, and in those two layers we can put our own data set. In those two layers we can put the weights associated with our own data set, and then we again execute it. So in that case we will get higher degree of accuracy if we will use pre-trained model. Okay, so this is known as fine tuning of models. So that you can explore. Okay. I will share you some links, some books also that you can explore for fine tuning of models, for changing the layers. Suppose as VGG16 is having 16 layers. So what you can do, you can remove some layers, some intermediate layers. Now how to remove those layers? Now you can see that it is having some convolutional layers. Actually these topics are concerned with deep learning, that we will be covering in further session. Okay, what you can do at this particular point, you can add your own data, you can add your own layers. Okay, and then we can retrain the model, and after retraining the model, we will be working with our own data set. So we can put our own 50-100 images in this particular data, in this existing data. So we will conclude this session. You can ask your queries. Dear participants, you can ask your queries. Tomorrow we will be having session of deep learning, and then we will be covering these points in tomorrow's session.
Any question, participants, please go ahead and write it in the chat box. Sir, many of them are requesting to share this Google Collab code.
Okay, fine. I will share this particular code.
Sir, one question from Ms. Shikha. What are the parameters we analyze in feature point extraction?
Please repeat, sir.
What are the parameters we analyze in feature point extraction?
Actually, in case of feature points extraction, the algorithm itself evaluates the image or video in case of feature points extraction. Okay, so if you are not getting the sufficient feature points, in that case we have to modify the data set in such a way so that more feature points can be evaluated. So it is better to take benchmark data, that earlier we have also covered it. Suppose you are working on flowers detection or image detection or some particular X-ray detection, so take benchmark data. In that case, there will be no issue of feature points. Yes,
sir. Sir, there was one more question from Ms. Shikha only. From where we can get real-time database for practice?
From UCI you can take the data sets, from IEEE data port also the data sets are available, from Kaggle also these data sets are available, and some more links are available that I will share you with the study material. Next question, sir.
Yes, sir, I'm going through the next question from Swagata Sarkar. Could you suggest any EEG and facial image databases for emotion detection?
Yes, in that you can go for PhysioNet. There is a repository PhysioNet. Suppose you are working on EEG data, that is brainwave data or brain fingerprinting data, that you can go for. PhysioNet is available on UCL also, you can go for it.
Next question from Mr. Bipin Singh. How to optimize a pre-trained deep learning model for the purpose of using on different image data set?
Yes, that I have just covered, that in case of pre-trained model, there is a particular file that is automatically created. Whenever we use Keras or TensorFlow, there is a model file created with extension .h5, H5 extension. Okay, I'm repeating, .h5 file is created for the model, and that H5 file is having the model structure along with the weights. On that H5 file, we modify the weights and we put our own data set. We put the weights of our own images, and then we read that H5 file in the prediction at the time of classification, at the time of recognition.
Participants, any more questions, you can write it in the chat box, please. We have a question from Virendra Singh, sir. How many types of video filters in OpenCV?
In OpenCV, you can explore the documentation. At least 10 types of video filters will be available. And all these are fully customizable. Okay. So I will share you some ebooks also.
Next question from Mr. Gurpreet Singh. Can you please tell us the area which is untouched in machine learning?
In machine learning, as in yesterday's session also, we have covered the domain of sentiment mining. So sentiment mining or image analytics or sentiment mining on images, that is still under research. However, we can't say that it is untouched. And as far as some novel algorithm is concerned, some novel approach is concerned, we can integrate blockchain technology. Okay. So the integration of blockchain with your image data sets for image forensics, that you can work out. Decentralized cloud implementation, that we can work with.
Next question from Mr. Karan Mahajan. Can we use shaped file images in OpenCV for image extraction?
Yes, definitely. Any type of image, any type of data set we can use. If that particular thing is not available, we can transform it. In C++, APIs are available. In Java also, these APIs are available.
Next question is from Virendra sir. How we can implement image stitching in OpenCV?
Yes, image stitching libraries are also available in this, that I will share you in the documentation part. So whatever documentation I will give you, that will have all these things, image stitching and video filters, and how to perform other operations on different types of videos, how to mix videos. I'm having some more codes also, but because of time constraint, we can't cover. Okay, how to extract videos, how to work on video fingerprinting, all these things are available.
Next question from T. Rajalakshmi. Can you apply these algorithms in audio comparison like images?
Please repeat your question.
Can you apply these algorithms in audio comparison like images?
Yes, definitely, like signal processing. Actually, in images, at the back end of every image, at the back end of every video, there is a matrix. Okay, so audio is basically a speech file, or speech is a particular audio file. Audio is a waveform. So same type of implementation we can perform on those data sets also.
Next question from Mr. Mrigang Singha. Is there any practical implementation done in cognitive science related to image processing?
That I will show you, I will share you by mail. You can communicate me separately. Okay, all these codes I am having, so I will show you. I will send you some detailed manuals on all these things.
Next question from Mr. Gurpreet Singh. Can we implement quantum model in deep learning model?
Sir, this topic is under research, and as far as existing implementation is concerned, it is not done. It is still under research, but it can be implemented. Implementation of quantum model can be done. But as far as GitHub repository is concerned, the codes will not be available. Still, the existing codes can be customized.
Next question from Tanaji sir, where to get agricultural crop image data set?
From UCI library you can have it, UCI repository, from Kaggle also you can get this data. From data.gov also these data sets are available. Okay. And as far as the specific data set of a particular region is concerned, what you can do, it is very simple process. However, it may take some time, but you can do, you can ask for the concerned department. Okay, via RTI also you can ask for the data set. Nobody will deny you. If you are ready to pay for that particular data, suppose I want to take the data set of Karnataka, I want to take the data set of agricultural scientists research board. Okay, so what I can do, I can file an RTI, right? And in that particular thing, we can ask for the specific data for research and development. They will ask minimum amount of money, and then we will be able to work with real time data.
Next question from Mahindra sir. All these process image, can we use it for data processing, binary data?
Yes, yes. Anything you can implement. So actually, OpenCV is for computer vision, for images and videos. In addition to that, you can perform implementation with the traditional data sets also. So classical data sets also can be processed.
Any example he's saying?
Just a minute. Any example, currently I am not having that particular thing, but separately I will share you that particular scenario. Okay, you can communicate separately if you are working on a specific task.
Yeah, any specific question related to somebody, you can directly mail sir, email it to sir, so he'll answer, not an issue. So no more questions now sir. So
okay, sir.
Thank you so much for a wonderful session, and thank you to the participants also. So tomorrow we meet at 9:30 a.m.